Welcome to my thesis presentation on procedural image generation using Markov chain wave function collapse. Procedural content generation is a method of using assets and logic to generate different gameplay experiences. By using some cellular automata functions, games use mathematical noise and random numbers to create content such as maps and levels. The image on the left is a visualization of noise in two dimensions. The image on the right highlights how a few passes of cellular automata and smoothing can use noise to create a map. Another visualization showcases raw noise on the left and noise with smoothing applied on the right. Notice how simple smoothing algorithms can give results that almost seem like a 2D platformer game level. It is common to also use adjacency rules to determine regions on a map or use randomness as height as shown in the image on the right. Noise-based procedural content techniques have been used in a variety of games over a long period of time. An example of PCG from early games is SimCity 2000, which is seen on the left, where it uses noise to generate its terrain. Similarly, in modern games like Minecraft, as can be seen on the right, the game uses 3D Perlin noise to generate the game world. Wave function collapse is another procedural content generation algorithm. However, it differs that it is no longer noise-based. It is instead an example-driven, content-agnostic, constraint-based algorithm. Let us talk about these attributes further. In this image, we can see that wave function collapse accepts an input and generates outputs that follow the similar rules as the input. This is an example-driven algorithm. It uses examples, but these examples are clearly different from each other in terms of color and size choices. So the algorithm is content agnostic. It uses some constraints to solve the patterns it observes in the input, so it is constraint based. And from the image that we saw of generating flowers, it follows an iterative, almost human-like generation process, which we will talk about. In two dimensions, wave function collapse accepts an input sample and identifies subsections in the input sample called kernels. It identifies, in this case, the first row of kernels of size 3x3, which look as such. For the third kernel, since the kernel is exceeding the bounds of the image, we will infinitely wrap around the image till enough area can be sampled by the kernel. Once we sample the kernels, we end up with something that looks like this. We use these kernels as constraints to generate an output, and it's interesting to note that in this output, every kernel-sized region in the output image maps perfectly to a kernel observed from the input. This holds true for all kernel-sized regions in the output image. To understand the constraints used by wave function collapse further, let us consider a Sudoku board. In a Sudoku board, the constraints are that in a 2x2 sub-region, in this case, that is highlighted by the thick borders, all the cells must have the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4. This constraint is also true for all rows and columns in this map. Using these constraints, we are easily able to solve this Sudoku board. How we do so is by identifying an empty square, checking against the column, identifying what number possibilities can exist at the cell, checking against a row, eliminating any unusable choices, and finally, when we have only one choice for the cell, we set its value. Let us now define entropy for a two-dimensional space. Entropy in a two-dimensional space is the number of possible outcomes that can occur at any given cell in that space. So in this case, the four empty cells have the number choices of 2 and 3. The entropy is now 2 at each of these cell locations. By applying the constraint to find the lowest entropy, we are able to resolve the entropy at each cell to an entropy value of 1, which means now we can solve this problem. The propagation of entropy is also interesting in that when the entropy is resolved for one of the cells by checking against its rows or columns, after applying the selected value, the entropy of the neighboring unresolved cell is immediately affected, which means that entropy resolution propagates to the unresolved neighbors. On completion, the board looks like this, where entropy at each cell is 1, there can only be one value possible at each cell location, and that is how we know that the board is complete. How does this relate to wave function collapse? Well, if we consider Sudoku but with colors, the color board of Sudoku is basically how wave function collapse functions, in that the entropy is a color choice now and no longer a number. We still want a cell with an entropy of 1, and we wish to iteratively resolve the entropy for the entire image. The process followed by WFC starts by first picking a random location in the output and setting the value at a cell. After we set that value, we propagate the selection to immediate neighbors. These neighbors then calculate their own entropy and continue propagating this information. To solve the output image, we require constraints which come from kernels observed from the example image. How we use the kernel as constraints are by overlapping the kernel in the output region to check if the overlap was a valid overlap. By overlapping them, we can now tell that the color choices as highlighted in this image are of entropies 1, 2, and 2, where the top right corner pixel has an entropy of 1 with only one choice that can exist. By resolving that pixel, we are now able to propagate the selection and help resolve any unresolved neighbors in the immediate vicinity of the resolved pixel. This is basically what we discussed when we talked about the Sudoku resolution. By overlapping kernels and identifying only one possible color for each of these pixel locations, we are now able to ensure that the entropy is 1, apply that choice, and repeat the process throughout the image. This allows us to use these choices and create patterns such as the flowers, as we can see in the image highlighted here. By visualizing this process, we can see that the blurry images that represent an average of all the possible colors at any cell location slowly resolve into fixed colors which represent the entropy being resolved to 1. This appears almost human-like in generation, where the flower starts from the root and ends at the apex. So now we know what content agnostic and example driven are. We also understand that the constraints come from kernel matching, and this is human-like generation only because we solve for the lowest entropy, which is the minimum entropy heuristic. What this lets us do in 3D is, since this algorithm is content agnostic, it can also use 3D visualization data of 3D regions and generate outputs. This is called the overlapping wave function collapse implementation because it overlaps kernels to determine output. This is the implementation proposed by Maxim Guman in 2016, and it uses input samples to generate images, as we discussed before. The overlapping wave function collapse architecture involves two stages: the loading steps and the WFC execution steps. The loading steps involve reading an input, identifying the kernels, creating a wave function collapse propagator, and generating the output image. The execution of WFC involves resolving entropy, checking if the entropy resolution succeeded, and in the case that it does, save the image. There is, however, a problem with overlapping wave function collapse. As we can see, the image on the left generates perfectly fine, but on the right side, with some intricate shape in the input image, we lose detail in the output. What we notice is that we are losing control over the proceduralness as we increase kernel sizes when using overlapping wave function collapse. But when we have smaller kernel sizes, the control is existent, but the shapes are distorted. So the drawbacks of overlapping wave function collapse are: every time there is too much detail, such as too many colors, intricate shapes will almost always come out wrong. Pixel-based adjacency constraints or kernels are basically just not good enough. We require a better model, one that can handle more colors, handle more intricate shapes, and handle constraints that are not purely pixel-based. What other PCG algorithms do to address this problem is they use a tile grid, and each tile represents an image. So by mapping images to tiles, they are able to account for a lot more detail while generating procedural results. By using a tile map, each tile is an image, and random assignment of the tile maps to the output, again as can be visualized, can create a lot more detail in the map. So that is what we are going to do. From overlapping wave function collapse, instead of using a pixel grid, we are now going to use a tile grid. We are going to use color as choices in the first case, but in the tiling case, use tiles as choices. And in the tiling wave function collapse model, we do not wish to split the image into kernels. Instead, we expect some neighborhood constraints to come as the form of tile adjacency. What I mean by all this is, in the first case, we used to assign a color to any pixel location. Now, we are assigning a block of colors as a tile to each tile location in the output image. So what has changed is, we are no longer in a pixel grid, we are in a tile grid. We are no longer assigning colors, we are assigning tiles. We are no longer cutting up kernels. Instead, we are going to do something else about constraints. How constraints work in tiling wave function collapse are, each constraint is a left tile to right tile relationship or an adjacency rule between two tiles. These tiles can also be oriented, rotated, and we will provide all of these constraints in the form of metadata to the algorithm. When we compare the results of overlapping wave function collapse and tiling wave function collapse, we see that OWFC has a very slow kernel identification process and generates output slowly with larger images. In the case of TWFC, however, we don't have any kernel identification step. This allows us for a real-time performance algorithm. It can also handle large image sizes because now all the complexity is left to tiling. Applying wave function collapse on tile maps gives us results as can be seen here, with a lot of detail and intricate shapes. It can even make circuits. Tiling wave function collapse implementation, to summarize, is different in that overlapping wave function collapse takes an input image and identifies kernels, whereas in the tiling case, we take metadata and a bunch of tile images that are provided as inputs to the algorithm. The architecture is still consistent of loading steps and wave and execution steps for WFC, but the loading steps are now different in that we first parse metadata, read all the possible tiles, generate tile symmetries, create the propagator, and then create the output image. The execution of wave function collapse is still the same in that we are resolving entropy, except for this time we don't resolve pixel entropy, we resolve tile entropy. And in on successful entropy resolution, we save off the image. What this means for developers is, by eliminating the kernel identification step, we are now a very high speed algorithm. The tiling wave function collapse algorithm is also able to generate complex images because through tiles it is able to handle detail. Detail is now added as required. The tiling wave function collapse is faster, but we have a drawback in that the design time for the tiling wave function collapse algorithm is very high. What we mean by the design step is, if we look at what the algorithm requires, it requires tiles and metadata. We are now going to look at what is in the metadata. The metadata is a collection of all the constraints required by the algorithm as left to right tile relationships. This is required to be manually generated and can increase drastically in complexity with increasing image sizes. So we need to fix this problem. To fix it, we will take a look at the advantages and drawbacks of both overlapping and tiling wave function collapse models. The OWFC model requires just an image and can create kernels from the patterns observed in the input sample. Whereas the TWFC model is very fast runtime and provides control over the proceduralness. The disadvantage of OWFC is that making kernels is slow and there is not much control in the algorithm. The TWFC disadvantage is that making metadata is really slow. This gives me an idea. What if we can propose an implementation that uses the best of both worlds? The loading steps now require further steps, but they utilize both the advantages of the existing algorithms. The Markov chain implementation parses metadata, reads tiles, and generates tile symmetries like in the case of tiling wave function collapse. But upon doing so, it also reads input samples, observes for tile instances, and generates constraints, very similar to the case of overlapping wave function collapse. Upon doing so, it creates a propagator and then generates the output image. The execution of wave function collapse, however, has remained the same. It still resolves entropy and writes the image off to a file if entropy resolution has succeeded. By applying the best of both worlds, we have used the idea of kernels from the overlapping wave function collapse model, as well as the idea of tiling for details from the tiling wave function collapse model. How MKWFC works is, we look for a tile instance in the input sample, make it the head of a Markov chain link. We observe what neighbors exist for that head instance and insert those neighbors as links to its Markov chain. We repeat this process for every tile instance in the input sample by observing the neighbors and creating corresponding Markov chain links. Eventually, we have a set of Markov chains for each tile instance and their corresponding links. By automating this process of identifying the neighborhood constraints, we have eliminated the requirement for writing meticulous hand-curated metadata and simply pass an image like in the case of overlapping wave function collapse. The benefits of doing this is when generating an image as shown in the screen, TWFC requires an image design step and a metadata design step. The image design step is required to infer constraints, whereas the metadata design step is required to specify the constraints as left-right relationships for the algorithm. If a redesign is required, we need to repeat both steps as highlighted above. In the case of MKWFC, however, we have completely eliminated the requirement to design metadata manually. If a change is required in this algorithm to generate outputs, well, we only require to make a new image and pass it as input to MKWFC. In terms of scaling, tiling wave function collapse requires hours of hand-curating data. Any redesign is time-consuming and is prone to human error. Markov wave function collapse, however, automates the constraint identification step, so redesign only adds milliseconds to the runtime. It also eliminates human error while identifying constraints. The scaling was improved in the design pipeline. By taking the TWFC design pipeline of designing an image, observing constraint and listing the data, and eliminating the observation and listing steps by automating the input process of MKWFC. So now the MKWFC design pipeline is simply a design of an image and execution of the MKWFC algorithm. Our hypothesis so far is that the tiling wave function collapse implementation is requiring high design time, needs metadata, and is prone to human error. The MKWFC implementation has an effectively free redesign. Automation simplifies the metadata and eliminates human error. But we need to confirm all of these statements via an experiment. Our comparison experiment to compare MKWFC against TWFC used 6 different image types and generated 3 different image sizes, as can be seen on the screen. It performed 10 tests per image, which resulted in a total of 180 TWFC trials and 540 MKWFC trials. We compared diversity, and diversity is defined as the number of unique constraint pairs that were either used in the input or in the output. After measuring the diversity, we have also measured the execution times of both algorithms. We required an equation to calculate constraint pairs for any tile map. For this, in any n by n image, we described epsilon as the equation of alpha plus beta plus gamma, where alpha represents the number of unique constraint pairs in the central region of the image excluding the border tiles. Beta represents the constraint pairs for all the border tiles excluding the corners, and gamma represents the number of constraint pairs for just the corner tiles. In this case, n is equal to 5, so calculating the value of epsilon, or the total number of constraint pairs, gives us a result of 80. When visualizing the constraints we had read from inputs for both the tiling wave function collapse and Markov wave function collapse algorithms, we found that in the case of a small input image, tiling wave function collapse identified 88.76% of the total constraints identified by MKWFC. As we increased the size of the inputs, we observed that tiling wave function collapse was only identifying 46% in this case of all the constraints identified by MTWFC. And as we increase that size, the percentage of coverage or the diversity of the constraint pairs observed in the inputs reduced for tiling wave function collapse. So as input size is increased, TWFC diversity of constraint identified reduced. When generating outputs, we observed that when generating a small output, tiling wave function collapse used 98.72% of the constraints utilized by MKWFC. However, as we increased the output sizes, we observed that the tiling wave function collapse model used much significantly lesser diversity of constraints as compared to MKWFC. So this means that MKWFC has more diversity in all cases when generating outputs. Because the diversity is high, we have much more constraint options, and by increasing the number of constraint options, we have automatically increased the quality of procedural content. This can be seen through the observed phenomena highlighted here. The image on the right has some instances of these castle blocks appearing where the tiling wave function collapse model had no such instances. This is a result of greater diversity. We can also control the diversity by manipulating the Markov chain links, but we were able to prove that the Markov chain wave function collapse model is able to identify much more constraint pairs as compared to TWFC. When we compare the execution time of both algorithms, we will first look at the tiling execution time for Markov chain WFC as well as the TWFC execution time. On comparing them, we noticed that the TWFC execution time was fairly consistent. However, the MKWFC tiling step was inconsistent and increased as the input size increased. This is a result of identifying larger constraint coverage. Due to the increase in diversity, the number of constraints that need to be compared against has also increased, making MKWFC slightly slower than TWFC. When we compare the constraint identification time, tiling wave function collapse constraint design time takes approximately 3 to 4 hours in the case of small images, 6 to 8 hours in the case of 10 by 10 images, and 14 to 18 hours in the case of large 25 by 25 images. However, by automating this process in Markov chain wave function collapse, we are able to do the same work in milliseconds. So, to re-summarize, tiling wave function collapse takes 3 to 4 hours, whereas MKWFC does it in 1 to 1.5 seconds. 6 to 8 hours is converted to 4 to 5 milliseconds. 14 to 18 hours is converted to 25 to 30 milliseconds. Simply by automation, we have reduced the design time from hours to milliseconds. So some conclusions that we can make from our experiment is that MKWFC provided greater constraint coverage in all cases. By automating constraint identification, we have reduced design time significantly from hours to milliseconds. MKWFC is still able to perform in real time. It also eliminates human error through this automation by not requiring the designer to manually sit and hand curate all of this metadata. By being fast, allowing for detail, and allowing for design iteration, wave function collapse maintains to stay real-time and provide greater diversity than tiling wave function collapse.